Ma'am, shall we start now? Yes, ma'am. Participants, please mute your mic and camera. And shall we start the session? Leadership and learning are indispensable to each other. Good morning, everybody. On behalf of Kalpaganayaka College of Engineering and Technology, Department of Biotechnology, I welcome you all for the second day session of virtual workshop on nanotechnology and pharmaceutics. I heartily welcome our today's speaker, Dr. S. Mohanaruban, Assistant Professor, Senior Grade, Department of Chemistry, Chemistry of Heterocycles and Natural Products, Research Laboratory, School of Advanced Science, Vellore Institute of Technology, Vellore. Welcome you, sir. I invite Dr. A. Sheila Devi, Assistant Professor, Department of Biotechnology, to introduce our today's speaker.
On behalf of our Biotechnology Department, Intuit Impact Lab, and Internal Quality Assurance Cell, Kalpaganayaka College of Engineering and Technology, I would like to take this opportunity to welcome our honorable speaker and beloved director, madam, principal, sir, head of the department, biotechnology, staff members, participants from KIMS and KVCTNs to the online workshop, day two session on an overview of bio-assisted synthesis of nanomaterials and their prospective applications. And I wish to introduce our respectable speaker, Dr. S. Mohanaruban, sir. He has completed his bachelor's degree in chemistry from VHNSN College, Vizhinagar. He did master and PhD in organic chemistry from VIT University, Vellore. He also did MBA from Bharatiya University, Coimbatore. He has published 177 research and review articles and completed 8 major funded projects, cost of 81 lakhs. He is recipient of VIT Research Award, Dr. Science Excellence, Young Scientist Award, Professor C.N.R. Rao Young Scientist Award by Bo Science Society. He also won Chinese Chemical Letters Best Paper Award and Best Outstanding Research Paper Award. We are really happy to have you as a speaker for this event, sir. And participants, I hope that all of you will enjoy the workshop. Now, without further delay, I will turn the time over to our speaker. Please, sir.
Hello, is it audible?
Yes, sir, you are audible, sir.
Okay, thank you, ma'am. Thank you for your nice introduction, ma'am. First of all, I would like to thank the coordinator, Ms. Mohanapriya, for her invitation to present here. So also, I would like to thank DPT, DSP for their financial support. I would like to extend my sincere thanks to my PhD scholar for their At least, I would like to thank the VIT management for their continued support and encouragement. I'm delighted to be here and to be invited for delivering a lecture on an overview of bio-assisted synthesis of nanomaterials and their prospective applications. So my overall talk will be going to concentrate about the importance of nanomaterials and how we can prepare this nanomaterials by biosystem methodology, that is eco-friendly methodology and applications of nanomaterials. Yes. Why nanomaterials? Wherever we are going, whatever the product you are seeing, even simple detergents, wherever you are seeing, they are saying it is a nano. What is the reason for going behind the nanomaterials? There are certain reasons. The nanomaterial is the backbone for the development of new technologies, new products, as well as getting a new market and financial rewards. These are the reasons to go behind the nanomaterials. So what are nanomaterials? So the nanomaterials is nothing but a nanometer is 1 millionth of millimeter. That is approximately...
Excuse me, sir.
Yes, sir.
Are you sharing slides, sir?
Yeah, I'm sharing slides.
We can't able to see that.
1 minute, sir.
Yes, sir.
Hello. Hello,
yes,
sir.
Able to see, sir. Yes, sir. It is visible,
yeah.
Sir.
Okay, thank you. So, what is nanometer? Yes, sir. Can I continue? Hello. Okay, so nanometer is 1 millionth of millimeter. It is approximately more than 10,000 times smaller than diameter of our human hair. So researchers have not consistently settled in the exact definition of nanomaterial. They agree they have partially characterized by either spinning size measured in nanometers. Okay, so nanomaterials are nothing but at least one dimension has to be less than 100 nanometer. So here nanoscale materials well little to be seen with the exposed light. So coming to this classification of nanomaterials, generally we can classify into two types. One is isotropic, so another one is anisotropic. So when it is isotropic, what is meant by this isotropic nanomaterial? It's nothing but the properties are identical in all directions. It means yes. Hello. Hello. I have given share. Hello. Hello. It is good. Now, ma'am, is it visible? Hello. Actually, sir, 1 minute, ma'am. Yeah, 1 minute. I will leave and I will join again then.
Yes, ma'am.
Hello. Hello. My face is blue, ma'am.
Yes, sir. Your slides are visible, sir.
What does it mean? The zero dimension means all three dimensions, okay? Length, breadth, width, all the three directions are in nanoscale. Example, nanoparticles are well separated nanoparticles, nanopowders that will come under dimension, whereas one dimension means only one dimension is outside the nanoscale. It may be a length, a breadth, or width. Any one will be outside the nanoscale. The examples are nanotubes and nanorods. Whereas two-dimensional materials, two-dimensional, either length or breadth, width and length, any two things will be outside the nanoscale. The best example is nanosheet and nanofilms. Then three-dimensional, 3D, three-dimensions are, whereas 3D nanosheets, all the three dimensions are outside the nanoscale. It's a different kind of, like a different distribution of nanoparticles, a group of nanowires, they can call it as 3D. So you can see this diagram. So the first one is zero dimensional. It may be a spheres or either spheres or clusters. Whereas 1D is a rod or wire shape. Whereas two dimensions are like nano films. It's like okay. Three dimensions are multi mono layers and it's like a misinterpretation area. Right. The next nanomaterials. Why the people are focusing much too much nanoparticles? Nanoparticles are nanomaterials. They are very some uniqueness. When you are comparing to the bulk materials, when you are going to the nano level, totally the entire properties are changing. For example, if you are taking titanium dioxide or zinc oxide, when it is going to the nano scale, it is in the transparent in nature. That's why it was having application like sunscreen lotion. So you can see the sunscreen lotion, it was added the same ingredient. So, apart from this, these nanomaterials have a range of potential application. It's like in short term and long term. In short term, it is like the cosmetics, textiles, even paints. For the body. So, nice different property. So, when you are preparing the same nanoparticle with a different color or the properties, it's totally will. Seven times harder and tougher than the melting point, boiling point, optical properties, electrical properties, band gap, everything it will be. Then where these nanoparticles can be formed. These nanoparticles can be formed naturally, like fine dust and sand, even biological matter, then organic ash, like this is naturally available. So, even if you want to dry some excrement in your house, if you are having a silver coat, in and around the environment, it will be like a small quantities of silver nanoparticles released spread over there. It is released from the silver coat. If you are having microscope, it is easy to identify. The synthetic nanomaterials, so that's why the people are focusing towards this synthetic nanomaterial. It can call it as anthropogenic nanomaterials. It means man-made nanomaterials. These synthetic nanomaterials are coming under two categories. One is incidental nanomaterials. What is mean incidental? So it will have like a different size. Even the elements, different types of elements will be like the shapes will be different. Whereas these engineered nanoparticles are well defined. You can see this diagram, even that cell material and the core shell, then the coating, everything will be uniform. Whereas the incident is totally different. The size, the shape, everything will be different. Okay, like this we can categorize. Now, the current science, in modern science, the nanotechnology is gaining more attention in the research field. And if you are taking any field, okay? So, all the fields, the nanotechnology is gaining more attention. So, because these nanomaterials are the building block for the nanotechnology development. So, these particular nanomaterials can be applicable in different methodology or different approaches. In material sense, even the people say that green synthesis, or we can say, say that in biotechnology, they will say that it is a biosynthesis. What is in a biosynthesis? By using this methodology, like we can go for the environmental friendly approach. It means it is a sustainable method and eco-friendly method as well as it is a reliable method. By using this methodology, even you can prefer like metal, metal oxide, even hybrid method, also biosphere materials can be achieved by using this biosynthesis. That's why experts are focusing much more on the biosynthesis. So, the preparation of nanomaterials, it's like a top-down approach or bottom-up categories. Top-down means by reducing size. It's like from bulk material to you're making to the fine atoms, like small fibers. Whereas bottom-up approach is like small atoms, they are going to make it into a cluster and particles and powder and then bulk. Like that, you're going to make it from bottom to top. That is two categories. If you are taking the top-down methods, many methods are there. A few of the methods are listed out here, like sputtering method, thermal method, explosion method, and ball milling method. Whereas this bottom-up method, examples are chemical, soldier method, spray method. What I am going to discuss today, that is bio-assisted nanomaterial preparation, that will come under the bottom-up method. So that's what we are going to discuss in detail for the remaining session. So coming to the environmental friendly, okay? So why do we need bio-assisted approach? What is meant by bio-assisted approach? Why we have to go for the bio-assisted method? As I said earlier, so bio or green approach means it is a sustainable method, environmental friendly method, okay? So how does, so due to this, the people are focusing much towards this method. So before going for this method, I would like to recall you about some of the incidents happened in India. So one of the things, Bhopal gas battery, it happened in Bhopal. The year of 1984 is one of the worst industrial accidents in our history. Almost 40 tons of methyl isocyanate had been accidentally released when holding a tank overheated at Indian Carbide Precipitate Plant. Means this is one of the precipitate plant. They have produced carbamide. This is a pesticide. They have produced this particular pesticide. While preparing this carbamide, this methyl isocyanate, this chemical has been stored in the tank. Due to the overheat, what happened? Explosion happened. Due to this, more than 15,000 people have been died in India and hundreds of thousands of people are injured. Now the question is, why this incident occurred? The people may say that it is overheated, wrong management, and the leakage of water, many issues. From my point of view, the bigger mistake, what happened is, the designing of this protocol for producing this material, that is carbamide, that is wrong. Okay? So the design is, if the design is eco-friendly or environmental friendly, obviously this incident might be not occur. Okay? So now the next question is whether still the people are preparing this carbamide. Of course, the people are preparing this carbamide. There is no change at all. You can see the method. This is the earlier method in Bhopal they have used, okay, to prepare this carbamide. They have reacted this compound 1, naphthol, to methyl isocyanate. This methyl isocyanate only stores in the tank and it explodes. This methyl isocyanate, how they prepare it? Methylamine and phosgene. Okay, this is the process occurred in Bhopal approach. Now, again they are same reactant, compound 1, 2, 3 they are using, but there is no possibility of getting this type of incident again. The reason is, they are taking this naphthol and they are reacting with this phosgene. When they are reacting with carbon 3, they are getting this naphthalene 1 YL carbonyl chloride. Okay? this intermediate, even if you are scrolling a certain okay, it will not, any explosion will not happen. This molecule has been further reacted with the molecule 2, that is methylamine, they got for the rain. Okay, this is a new approach the people are following. So, the incidence, you are saying rectangularly, the incidence is the wrong approach. That is the mode of origin is wrong. Okay, that's right. So, now I would like to recall, if you want to stop all this type of accident, okay. So what you have to do is, the designing of the protocol must be eco-friendly, okay? That's why the people, the company is moving towards a sustainable method, that is biosynthesis or bio-assisted method, okay? I think you know many things about even innovator disease.
Excuse me, sir.
Due to the mercury contamination in water.
Excuse yes? me, sir. Your slides are not visible. Your slides are not visible. Again.
Sir, it's visible.
No. We cannot see, we can see only this. And kindly check it out in chat option. Many of us have been, we are giving
okay.
us
I'm sorry, send PPT to you, can you share it? Already shared, ma'am. Hello? Okay. So I think it's visible for most of the people. Can I hear you?
Yes, sir. Continue.
So for avoiding all this type of problems, even accident, everything, so better we can go for safer protocol. That is, prevention is always better than cure. All the incident factor, how we can solve. Instead of that, we can fix the proper problems, right? So that's why. Right. Most of the researchers, people are using different kind of words like biosynthesis, ecological friendly method, or green synthesis, or phytosynthesis, or biological synthesis like that, or even biofabrication like that. Different names have been started. Okay. Now, I'm going to move towards the how we can prepare this particular nanomaterials by eco-friendly method or bio-assisted method. Okay. So, if you want to prepare some metal, okay, or metal oxide, or hybrid material, or bio-inspired material, you need always some chemicals or some reagents to reduce the metal or to oxidize the metal, as well as you need stabilizing and tapping agent. Okay, when you are looking at the EAA literature, most of the people might be used sodium ion. Okay, similarly, tapping agent, stabilizing agent, some matrix might be used. Right, so when you are doing it in a smaller scale, there is no problem at all. Okay, if you are doing the laboratory scale, if you are using chemical sodium chloride, nothing will happen. Or if you are using lithium chloride, nothing will happen. But when you are using bulk scale production, okay, there is a chance to get accident. Plus, it is explosive. For avoiding this, people started to use green chemicals. Okay, this is available from the natural source. Right? So, it's different from the research in, researcher interest. It may be a plant. Okay, plants for like fruits or vegetables, even algae, fungus or bacteria. Any natural source can be selected. From this, we have to extract the chemicals which is present in it. That is secondary metabolites which is present in this. That chemical has been used for the reducing agent or oxidizing agent or tapping and stabilizing agent to prepare the nanomaterial. Okay, so this is the first step. Natural source. This source you are going to select. Either plant, vegetables, algae, fungus or bacteria. Right. Then, once you have selected the bio source, how you can prepare the nanomaterial. Even this, first we are going to perform this, is not my institute also. Okay. Right. The first the thing is, you have to choose the source, bio source. Then it has to be washed with the distilled water and you have to keep it in the air dry. Once it is dry, you have to go for the powder. Okay, you have to make it powder by using mechanical grinder. Okay, then once you have made a powder, it has to be immersed in the suitable solvent for the extraction powder. It's called immersion technology. Okay, immersion method. So if you are immersing, then you can go for the filter. If you are filtering, you can see here, you can collect the extract. This extract can then varieties of secondary metabolites, that is the polyphenol, alkaloids. Okay, alkaloids, the many secondary metabolites will be present in that. That is going to act as a of raising agent or releasing agent or stabilizing agent, okay, capping agent. So then what you have to do is this extract has to be added with the suitable metal solution. If you want to prefer some silver nanobody, you have used silver nitrate as a metal solution. So then you have to add an extract and you have to adapt the suitable condition, either in the heating or room temperature, and then based on the facility available, you have to apply the suitable conditions and then you will get your desired nano material. Okay? So the first step is selection of natural source, then the next step is the synthesis of nano material. Now, the scientifically you have to prove how this is happening, instead of adding some reducing capping agent or oxidizing agent, how it's happening. Right. So that is for mechanism of the mechanistic pathway. So if you are having the metabolites, okay, like if you are having the secondary metabolites in your extract, okay, maybe for the person is having a polyphenol, when you watch it there, you are adding your metal salt solution. What will happen? This polyphenol will get oxidized. It will convert into oxidized form of polyphenol. Okay, this OH will convert it into ketone. During that time, this metal salt will get reduced. For example, if you are taking palladium salt, palladium 2+, it will convert it into palladium 0, palladium oxide. Okay, like that it will get reduced and you are going to get your desired 1D, 2D or 3D material. This is the mechanism behind it. Once the nanoparticle is formed, how will you confirm? So, general characterization, if you want to confirm the preliminary configuration, use the visual spectroscopy based on the absorption value. You can check whether some reaction changes occurs or not. Okay? Then, XRD analysis. By using this XRD analysis, you can find out the phase. Okay? Precision phase, whether it is IPR solved. FTAR will be helpful to find out the functional group of the molecule. Then coming to the scanning electron microscopy will be helpful to define the morphology of the material what you have prepared. Then TEM transmission information microscopy, it will be helpful to find the size of the nanoparticle. The next one is EDAX. EDAX will be helpful to find the element which is present in the materials. Okay? So the energy dispersive X-ray spectroscopy will be useful to find the elements. For example, if you are preparing some silver and palladium bimetal. So silver peak as well as palladium peak will be in your EDAX. These are the basic associations to confirm the nano material. So that your nano material is formed or not. Nothing is based in this course. Hello.
So as per the literature,
you have started to use fungus, okay, as well as flavors for preparing nanomaterial. DNA is very then you have used various vegetable plants also. Then we have, we thought why we have to waste this medicinal plant and other things. So also in the fungus medium, the process is costly. Okay, you need a broth and other thing, and as well as contamination possibility is more. So we need effective method, it is cost effective method, and you should not disturb the value product, okay, bio value product. That's why we have gone for the agricultural based product. Okay, that is Anonoma, this is Tascherapil. That peel has been used, that is Anonas sucumbens of peel. Okay, it has been used. Then this is nothing but beetroot. Okay, that peel has been used. Like that, we started to use various agricultural waste products. So then, we want to go for like particular waste. Okay, So what we have done is, we have checked the literature. You know that in India, coconut is there is nothing but coconut oil. Okay, the coconut oil they have used for preparing many materials, even though the wastage is high. Okay, but also if you are taking moringa oil, is drumstick. It's nothing but drumstick. Drumstick production is very easy. Okay, so the wastage of the peel is waste. Okay, certain period even the more production will be there, the wastage is high. So what we have done is, why not we can use the peel alone? Okay, peel alone for our collagen is always low toxic. Even if you are seeing the product, many products have been developed based on the palladium. For example, even jewelry, they started to use palladium. Apart from that, they are using as a catalyst in many purposes. Even for pharmaceutical company, they are using palladium as a catalyst for carbon-carbon bond forming reaction. Apart from that, even in coins, they are this palladium. Then it uses the water treatment equipment. Apart from the various industries, even in electronics, they are used this palladium. That's why we started to concentrate on the preparation of this particular palladium. Okay, bioresistance in this stuff, moringa oil extract, palladium nanoparticles. The first step is always when we are getting those, the cleaning process. Okay, so what we have to do is, we have to remove the dust which is present in the collect the moringa oil extract, and we have washed with distilled water. Then we kept for air dry, then made it into the powder, and it has to be sealed by getting uniform. Then we go on for the extraction process. Usually by using the extraction method, you can do it. Immersion method, you can do it. Okay, there are various methods. Still, we want to go for the eco-friendly method. So what we do is, why not instead of you are going for the soft slab, so you want to reduce the time of the process. In that purpose, you have gone for the non-conventional approach, that is microwave-assisted extraction. You can see here, this is the microwave which we have used. So you can keep your apparatus inside this equipment. Whatever the process is happening in, you can observe in this camera. Okay, this is actually are used for our purpose. You can see here, you know, the second step is extraction process. We have taken our moringa oil extract powder into the round bottom flask and we kept inside the microwave oven. The uniqueness of this microwave oven is, at a stage you can use it microwave, also you can use sonication, also in, use digital light. All the three source combined instrument. But we have used only microwave for our purpose, and we have done this optimization procedure by using response surface methodology, which is a mathematical tool. So we have varied the power, microwave power like 300, 400, 500, even temperature 65, 70, then solvent 30. By using this mathematical tool, the response surface methodology, we found that around 400 watts, 65 degrees Celsius, is 2 minutes time. By using 25 ml of solvent, there is a possibility of getting higher possibility of the yield. So we applied this conditions and we got good yield of the extract. That is methodic extract of moringa oilifera. This paper has been published in Journal of Pharmacology and Photobiology. Now, this extract we have used for the preparation of palladium nanoparticle. How we have prepared? So what we have done is, we have taken moringa oilifera and to that we have added 1 millimolar, 80 mg, further you have to add 2 mg, that is 2 mg in 20 ml of moringa oil extract. Okay, this is also optimized protocol. We have used even 1 mg, 3 mg, everything, and we have after doing the optimization, we found that only 2 mg in 20 ml with 80 ml of palladium acetate only is giving good product. Okay, so you have tried with this microwave at 300 watt, 60 degrees Celsius within this body. Nanoparticles, which has been gone for the centrifugation, okay, around 4000 RPM for 15 minutes, and they have done several times water wash for removing the negative metabolite, which is along with the same nanoparticles. They have done centrifugation, then they gone for the calcination at 300 degrees Celsius, okay, for 3 hours, and we got a solid particle which has been characterized to confirm the palladium nanoparticles. So, first we have done for the XRA analysis. Surprisingly, we got nice results. That's why we checked this palladium nanoparticle T, where this starred, okay, some of the peaks are marked with star. This is due to the secondary metabolites, which is entrapped on the palladium nanoparticles. Okay, so it is not impurity. We have done several times, like more than 3 to 4 times we washed here, even though till that molecules are entrapped along with the nanoparticle. It means it's like tapping agent, okay, tapping and stabilizing agent. So still we want to prove that our due to molecular molecules are extract only nanoparticles, only nanoparticles forming. For that we have done the control experiment without plant extract. You can see this X-ray, there is no peak, palladium peak here. Yes, there is no palladium peak, okay? Some other broad weight it is not related to palladium. So with this, you can clearly tell that only Moringa oleifera is acting as a reducing agent to convert palladium 2 to palladium 0. Okay? Right. Next, we have done FTAR analysis, palladium nanoparticle. In Moringa oleifera extract, you can see the appearance of OHC. This is due to the polyphenol. This OHC is acting as a capping and stabilizing reducing agent. So once it is tapped with this palladium nanoparticle, you can see this OHC has been disappeared. Then further, it has been confirmed by XPS, that is X-ray photoelectron microscopy. It provides the quantitative and chemical state information for the surface of the metal. Whatever the metal you are using, their chemical state will be here. You can see here, palladium has been appeared. Apart from that, you can see that carbon also. This is due to the compound, trichometabolic dispersal in the plant extract. Right. Now further, we have confirmed the particle size by using term analysis. Okay, it's a daily pattern, particle distribution histogram. It's really so that mostly 27 plus or minus nanoparticles are present in our metal. Okay, right. So, why we have to prepare for this nanoparticles? Okay, there are varieties of application. For example, if you are taking zinc oxide, it is useful in cosmetics, palladium oxide, it is useful in biocatalyst, or the biocatalyst, iron, it is antimicrobial, like that. Several applications are there. Okay, that's why palladium is used in the industry for carbon-carbon forming reaction as well as water treatment equipment, already I discussed. So, coming to our application, what we have performed for this nanomaterial. We have done hemolytic activity, you know, it is for finding the toxicity in red blood cells, okay, human blood. Then degradation, dye degradation, you know that thing is, nowadays many problems, majority of the problem is industrial waste water, okay. Is due to the industrial wastewater, what is getting contaminated. So what we have used our palladium as a catalyst to degrade the dye. Okay. Then antibacterial, antifungal, even catalysis, larvicidal and ovicidal activity. Like that, several applications discussed today. So coming to the antibacterial activity, we have used as per the reported method, MIC method. The dye is nutrient other block. So bacteria, 2 gram per 3 gram negative has been used. Amoxicillin is the standard drug we have used here, and the absorbance has been measured at 450 nanometer. You can see these results. When compared to the standard, even our nanoparticles are showing moderate activity. So this nanomaterials like palladium is having capability to interact with the protein portal and the cell membrane of the bacteria. And these can lead to damage the cytoplasm. Okay, it leads to damage the cytoplasm. So that is the mechanism behind it. This impact decreases the even cytoplasmic content on bacterial cells and leads to the cell death. Okay. Therefore, this palladium nanoparticles having the ability to damage the bacterial cell membrane and the exclusion of cytoplasm was followed by cell death. Okay. Right. So you can see this scientific proof. We have taken this same morphology of the bacteria before treatment and after treatment. You can see this morphology. It's like a rod shape. Even after the treatment, it is totally damaged. The shape has been collapsed. Okay, this is the evidence that our palladium is interacting with this cell wall, and it's even larger like. To prove that it is due to our nanoparticle, so we have after the death, we have taken this larva and we crushed and we have subjected to EDAX analysis. In EDAX analysis, you can find that palladium and carbon are present in that. Clearly prove that it is due to the larva death is due to the palladium nanoparticle. Further, we have done photocatalytic degradation of dye, that is methylene blue. Okay, at 70 minutes, the peak has been grossly disappeared. Okay, clearly shown that the methylene blue has been degraded at 70 minutes. Then we have done the hemolytic assay. We have collected the blood sample from the healthy volunteer, age of 25, B positive blood. The blood sample was allowed to centrifuge to get the supernatant liquid. Then 1 gram per ml solution. From that we have taken 25, 50, 75, 100 ml solution and solutions of palladium nanomaterials which has been added to the blood sample. Okay, then the phosphate buffer solution has been added, then it has been incubated. Okay, so after that we have calculated the percentage hemolysis at 540 nanometer. So this is the calculation: absorbance of sample minus absorbance of negative control, absorbance of positive control minus absorbance of negative control into 100. Okay, here we have used the Triton Nicosis standard. You can see this proof microbiological microscopic analysis. The negative control, you can see this image, whereas when you use the Triton X, okay, it was totally damaged. Whereas in compared to the palladium, it is not much lysis, it is only less lysis in the red blood cells. Okay, it's supposing for the it shows that the palladium nanoparticles are not participated in the cell surface. Okay, it's not much surface. Okay, so similarly, by using this methodology, like we have prepared various nanoparticles like silver, titanium dioxide, SnO2, even lead. Okay, and we have subjected for various application: antimicrobial, catalytic property, photocatalytic activity, even bimetal, nickel and palladium, metal oxide, SnO2, copper oxide, like that various nanoparticles has been prepared and it has been published. Now, we have found that when you are using the nanomaterial, when you are going to the nanomaterial, there is a possibility of getting agglomeration and you are going for the reusability. That's why we thought, why not we can concentrate on nanocomposites. Nanocomposites are nothing but it is the matrix which nanoparticles have been added to improve the particular property of the material. Okay, it's like you can take like a sheet to that surface, you can add the nanoparticles, it will enhance the properties. Okay, also it will not easily agglomerate. So that's why we thought of considering a nanocomposite. So the application of nanocomposites is useful in various fields, even food packing, automobile engine, then producing batteries with greater power output, like that various applications are there. So we thought of going for this composite. So for making a composite, we thought of using C3N4, it is nothing but graphitic carbon nitrate. Okay, this melamine has been the precursor. When you are doing the pyrolysis of this melamine at higher temperature, you will get graphitic carbon nitrate. This is the structure of graphitic carbon nitrate. So what we did is, the graphitic carbon nitrate and palladium has been combined to form the composite. Okay, we tried the atoms for making C3N4 with palladium nanomaterials. Okay, you can see here, first we have C3N4, the peaks appear here, XRDP. Then we tried for palladium. Some cases we observed palladium oxide. C3N4 palladium oxide composite we prefer. Then we need palladium alone. So again, we want to check this. This is maybe due to the the palladium has been converted into palladium oxide. So again we tried. So in several atoms, still we are getting the composition of either pure palladium oxide with C3N4 or we are getting palladium and palladium oxide with C3N4. Okay, so still we are not getting exact pure palladium of C3N4. Still we are trying for this. The method is we are optimizing. Apart from that, what the composite, we don't want to waste it. So what we did is, this composite we want to go for some applications. So we tried in the one of the important reaction in pharmaceutical industry. Okay, carbon nitrogen bond formation reaction, Buchwald-Hardwick reaction. So we take an amine and aryl bromide and we tried with this catalyst. The reaction was positive and we got good yield. Still the reaction is progress is going on. So apart from that, what we did is this Moringa oleifera peel. Okay, we have used this Moringa oleifera peel for preparing copper oxide nanoparticle. Then once we prepare the copper oxide nanoparticle, we tried copper oxide at carbon nanocomposite. Because this Moringa oleifera peel is nothing but it is made up of organic materials, okay, secondary metabolites. So what we did is we gone for the higher temperature in the furnace. This all the material has been converted into carbon and was deposited with the copper oxide. Okay, so you can see here, this is the evidence, it is bulk copper oxide, only bulk copper oxide of Raman spectra. You can see only Raman spectra, you can see only the copper oxide P. Whereas when you are going for this copper oxide carbon, there is other peaks, okay, extra peak. This is copper carbon peak. Okay, so we tried for antibacterial activity, it was positive, almost we got a good result. Okay, you can see this is a semi niche, okay, of the bacteria before treatment, after treatment. So coming to the toxicity, we done the chemolysis study also. So we can see here negative control. Okay, so So when you are comparing the radical control with the trioxin, the trioxin has been totally damaged. Okay, whereas copper oxide at carbon, okay, that is it shows that it is non-toxic. Okay, according to these results, these composites are not participated in cell proliferative process. There is no lysis in the red blood cells. Okay, so coming to the conclusions, so this still we are doing we are preparing more composite by using this secondary metabolite. So this Moringa oleifera and Coccus nucifera, it contains polyphenolic compound. That's why we have chosen this. Apart from that, this is agricultural waste. This polyphenol is acting as a capping and stabilizing agent to form nanomaterials. Okay. Also, this nanomaterials we have already been subjected for various applications, including biological as well as environmental applications. So these are some of the other composites we used by using the screen protocol. Ag3PO4 plus copper oxide. Recently, it was published in Optic. Okay, photoluminescent property. Then this is the gadolinium oxide Ag2O3 by using Moringa oleifera. We prepared and we published in the biotechnology process. Then silver chloride. So silver chloride is non-toxic as well. We have used the green source and we published in this material letter. Then again, this is zinc oxide preparation by Moringa oleifera and published in nanoscale research letter. So again, Moringa oleifera, Coccus nucifera oxide. So even we have done cancer study by using zinc oxide. So these are the other publications which we have prepared by using this agricultural waste. These are some of the references. Thank you for your patient listening. Now the forum is open for discussion. If you have any doubts, you can ask.
Sir, there is two questions for you. Shall I ask, sir? Hello? Hello, sir, I'm Dr. Rossi baat kar raha hu. Bhopal se, sir, kaise? सर आपको ई संजीवनी में नॉर्मल कर दिया आज बने अवेलेबल नहीं कोई अगर पेशेंट है अटेंसी या कोई बात नहीं तो आप कंसल्टेशन करके एक बार बात
what if we use plant without drying it for extract preparation? Yes, it's a good question. What will happen? You are directly taking the plant. Okay, directly you are taking the plant. I think the same way that even some of the in the dust all the particles will be there. That is the first thing. Okay, then when you are going for the drying, the purpose is without drying is to store the plant for long time. Okay. So if you are drying only in the nature, so nothing will happen to the secondary metabolite. But the thing is, once you prepare the extract, you can store it in the long time. Even the plant is dried, the plant powder has been stored for long time, but the leaf directly becomes stored for the long time. Okay, the fungus or something will become to the plant.
There is one more question, sir. In any nanomaterials,
I think no. I think in market there is no nanomaterials related to cancer. Okay, I think still the lab review work is going on, but I think in market level there is no anti-cancer nanomaterials. Okay. Anything else? Okay, ma'am. Thank you so much for your invitation.
Essence of all beautiful art, all great art is gratitude. I'm privileged to deliver a tote of thanks for the session. very informative session and valuable information shared by you, sir. Thank you for your accepting our invitation, sir. Participants, feedback link will be posted in the chat box. Kindly fill it. It will be marked as attendant for all the sessions. It will be active for only 30 minutes.